What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Recursion can be tough to understand, especially for new developers. And simply put, a recursive function is one that calls itself. But while developing or writing a piece of code, how do we know that we should call the same method we are implementing? And how to ensure, if we do this, that we will obtain the output and results we are seeking? To better understand the concept at hand, and as usual, let's take a practical approach. And suppose that your desktop is a messy one. You see your folders are scattered all over the place. And one day you encountered the need to find a particular picture. However, you cannot remember in what folder you last placed it. So, because you watch Geekific and you're awesome, you decided to implement a small method that searches for this picture. I know you can literally use the search bar, but just go with the example. Inside this method, you created a for loop that goes over the folders. Here, each folder is represented by a number. Then for each folder, you check if the picture you are searching for exists inside this folder. Then your method will return this folder number so you may directly go to it. However, if it doesn't, the for loop will continue until all folders are searched. That's easy, right? What we just implemented is what we call the iterative way of writing code. Because if you think about it, what we are doing is iterating over the folders one by one. And for each folder, we are applying or executing the same piece of logic. Moreover, while writing this piece of code, we clearly went through two different steps. First, we started by stating that we have 50 folders and created a loop to go over all the folders. And then the second step was creating the specific logic that will search inside each folder. However, to think recursively, you have to start with the specifics and then move to the parts of the code that take into consideration all the items that act similarly. What I mean by this is, if we were to write the same method in a recursive manner, what we'll do is start with a piece of code that should apply on each folder and put it inside a method. Now, the specific behavior for all folders is encapsulated inside this method. And based on the folder number we pass to this method, it will go ahead and search for our picture inside this folder. So if we pass 0 to this method, it will search inside folder number 0 and so on. All that is missing now is simulating the for loop we previously had. We want this method to go over all our folders. To do that, you could wrap the call we have in the main method with a for loop, sure. But what you can also do is call this same method with the current folder number plus one argument, in case we did not find the picture. So in the main method, when we call this recursive function, this method will go ahead and search inside folder number 0. And if it doesn't find the picture, it will call itself again with an argument of 1, and then attempt to find the picture in folder number 1. It will keep doing this until it finds the picture and returns with the folder number containing the picture. You see, recursion is about simulating a loop, all while taking into consideration that what is being applied on a single object is being applied on the whole group forming this object. You start by solving smaller portions of your problem until the original larger problem is solved. Our problem was not finding the picture inside one folder, but it was finding it among all the folders. However, what we started by doing is creating a method to find the picture inside one folder only, and by applying this same logic on all the remaining folders recursively, we were able to solve the larger problem at hand. Okay, there's something here that I may have left out in our previous implementation. And if you wanted to implement a method that matches exactly the for loop we had at the beginning of the video, it should look something like this. And to better understand and dive deeper in why we added this if statement and these return calls, let's take another example. And this one is a classic problem, calculating the factorial of a number. Now, as a reminder, a factorial of a number n is defined by n followed with an exclamation mark and is the result of multiplying the number 1 to n. So, a factorial of 5 is equal to 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, resulting in 120. To solve this problem recursively, and as we previously mentioned, what we need to do is search for what is being repeated or applied on all objects at hand and encapsulate it. Here we are not dealing with objects, but rather with numbers or integers. Hence, we need to find a certain formula, or a criterion that is being applied on all and each of the numbers forming this equation. Let's think about it. If factorial of 5 is 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1, what's the factorial of 4? Well, it's 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. So the factorial of 5 can also be written as 5 times the factorial of 4, right? Same applies to the factorial of 4, which can be written as 4 times factorial of 3, and so on. So, given any number n, we can write its factorial as n times the factorial of n minus 1. And in code, if we have a method named factorial that takes an integer as parameter and returns the factorial of this integer as a result, the logic written inside this method can consist of the recursive call you see in front of you. Now, you see what we wrote is nice and simple. However, our method still misses something. If we pass the integer 5 to this method, for example, it will be called indefinitely. Why? Well, let's try together. The first time we call it, it will have 5 as argument and will insert a first entry in the call stack of our memory. Next, it will be 4, then 3, then 2, then it will keep going. What's stopping it? Nothing. The result will eventually be a stack overflow exception. To solve this, we need to add what we call a stop condition or abort condition. This condition will tell our method to stop invoking itself recursively and hence start generating the result for us. In the example we gave at the beginning of the video, our abort condition was finding our picture, or searching inside all 50 folders. In this case, the factorials example, we said that all factorials of any number end with the factorial of 1. So the factorial of 5 will be considered as calculated when we reach 1, like 5 times 4 times 3 times 2 times 1. Or in case of the factorial of 3, for example, it is 3 times 2 times 1. So the stop condition we should add is if the integer we are receiving as a parameter to the method is 1. Then we simply return 1 without invoking the recursive call. Now, when calling this factorial method with an argument of 5, our call stack will look like this. And because the top item in the stack has no further invocations, it will return the integer 1. Hence allowing the next entry in the stack to calculate 2 times 1 and return 2. The next entry will return 6, followed by 24, and finally 120, which is our final result. That's how recursion works. You see, a recursive function should always return a value when a certain stop condition is satisfied without further invoking recursive calls. However, if the condition is not yet satisfied, then the function calls itself with an input which is a step closer to the stop condition. Okay, to make sure you got the idea of recursion, let's start to solve another problem, the Fibonacci sequence problem. As a reminder, the Fibonacci sequence is the series of numbers 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, 34, and so on. The pattern involves adding the two previous numbers in the series. So 0 plus 1 equals 1, 1 plus 1 equals 2, 1 plus 2 equals 3, 2 plus 3 equals 5, etc. In other words, the Fibonacci number at position n, for n bigger than 2, is the Fibonacci at position n minus 1 plus the Fibonacci at position n minus 2. To write this recursively, you might have already guessed that we should have a method that takes an integer as parameter. This integer will be the position of the Fibonacci we want to calculate, and that is returned by the method. So, if we pass to the method integer 7, it should return 13, as 13 is the Fibonacci located at position 7. Now, based on the definition we just established, the recursive method should be written as you can see in front of you. However, this method still misses something, right? And I think you guessed it, the stop condition. Here, because we have two recursive calls to the method, each with two different inputs, therefore we should have two stop conditions, the first one for position 0 and the second one for position 1. You see, the last invocation of the recursive method should look something like this. And if we provide only one of these stop conditions to the recursive call, it will keep calling itself indefinitely and will throw a stack overflow exception. Please let me know in the comments down below if you would like a part 2 video for this one, where we detail and go over the recursive methods we previously implemented in our trees series here on Geekific. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.